Phone check. 1, 2, the microphone check. 1, 2, 1, 2, the microphone check. I got my headphones tuned between two different AM stations, and my briefcase is full of declassified information. Declassified, declassified.
Good evening and welcome to News from Neptune for the 13th week of 2016. I'm Carl Osterbrook. For 25 years, this program has been a weekly hour of spontaneous and unrehearsed discussion of the news of the week and its coverage by the media. First on a so-called community radio station, but I was deplatformed there. Deplatforming is a recent coinage in the university and media. It means depriving someone of a place to speak because of what they're saying. I appreciate the chance to come to you now via Urbana Public Television and YouTube. Our program's name, News from Neptune, comes from Noam Chomsky, who's been writing sensible things about U.S. politics for half a century. Chomsky says that in the U.S. media, either repeat the same conventional doctrines everybody is saying, or else you say something true, and it will sound like it's from Neptune. Tonight, David Green and Ron Zook and I will try to say some true things. It's the 1st of April, a day for jokes, which explains Ron's hats, but one of the best-known lines in 20th century poetry claims April is the cruelest month, breeding lilacs out of the dead land, mixing memory and desire, stirring dull roots with spring rain. So instead of starting with our usual remembrance of cruel history, we'll turn to another poet, Philip Larkin. The trees are coming into leaf like something almost being said. The recent buds relax and spread. Their greenness is a kind of grief. Is it that they are born again and we grow old? No, they die too. Their yearly trick of looking new is written down in rings of grain. Yet still the unresting castles thresh in full-grown thickness every May. Last year is dead, they seem to say. Begin afresh, afresh, afresh. The contemporary American poet Mary Carr says that that last line sounds like a lawn sprinkler. Afresh, afresh, afresh. Well, so perhaps we'll begin afresh with our, with Ron Zook.
Yes, well, the Eliot line is similar to the first line of Chaucer's Canterbury Tales,
yep.
In which the pilgrims set out to Canterbury, and it's an interesting parallel. I wanted to plant some ideas here, and we'll have to
see if they grow, huh?
Yeah, and apply some fertilizer to them.
That's your characterization. I didn't have to do it. Yeah.
Right. So I'll be spreading some manure as usual today, and hoping that they permit other that'll permit other ideas to grow and flourish. I'll try to avoid comments on the political horse race and the droppings from the racetrack that I usually comment upon. Last time I mentioned a interesting polarization that's growing up in the discipline of economics. More and more dissatisfaction with the neoclassical paradigm, more people talking about behavioral or institutional economics. And I found a very interesting book by one David Hamilton called Evolutionary Economics. The first edition was apparently published as a dissertation back as long ago as 1953 by the University of New Mexico Press. It was called Newtonian Classicism and Darwinian Institutionalism. And his guide through the economics is the distinction between the Darwinian evolutionary paradigm and the Newtonian mechanistic paradigm. And I think it's an interesting distinction. He doesn't use the word paradigm, which became extremely popular a little later due to Thomas Kuhn's book, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. And actually, I audited a philosophy of science course once with Dudley Shapir from the University of Chicago, who had counted over 20 distinct uses of the term paradigm in the literature, And as usual, he wanted to recommend that people stop using it because it had become so messed up with contradictory interpretations. And it's like what Arthur Lovejoy did with the term Romanticism, showing that it had acquired so many different senses and meanings that it had become highly questionable and should stop using it. The same thing apparently was said by Richard Schacht about alienation a few years back, who was on the philosophy faculty here, I believe, now retired. And indeed, the same thing is now being said in religious studies about Gnosticism. What was it? And there are certain people who like to knock it, but it's hard to say what it is because, again, it has been used so many things that are incompatible with each other that it doesn't have much meaning left. This is the first, second, third century religious point of view about a higher esoteric type of knowledge. So one thing I did want to get to is this question, which keeps coming up again and again and gets a number of people excited and attempting to answer it, is why do blue-collar working class people so often vote Republican, which is not in their best interest, according to standard doctrine? And the best thing I've seen on this question is a suggestion that we can understand this paradox, as it appears to many, if we divide the voting population up into fifths, quintiles, and look at the difference between the lowest quintile, that is, those whose incomes is from are from 0 to 20% in the income distribution, and those between 20 and 40%. So the lowest quintile has a whole lot of black people, people on welfare, and so on. The next higher group, from 20 to 40%, has a lot of people in it who are in part-time and precarious jobs, that's the well-known precariat. And the point seems to be that the second quintile, those people from 20 to 40% in the income distribution, are highly moralistic about the bottom 20%. And they think that the bottom people are getting all kinds of free stuff that they don't deserve. This is the classic problem, then, of the undeserving poor. Everybody has a lot of sympathy for the deserving poor who are very virtuous and working hard and keeping their nose clean and obeying the law and so on. But it's the other group, the lumpen proletariat, if you like, or whatever, that they become very moralistic about. Now, I've had some experience of this myself. The people who are riding around in their pickup trucks with these stickers on them that saying, I'm paying for the welfare that's going to the very poor, or however they put it, trying to avoid open insults. But those people are getting something they don't deserve because they haven't worked for it. They just want handouts, and they want things to be given to them. And these people are often in the 20 to 40% bracket, are often what's called Reagan Democrats, and so on. And a lot of people seem unable to understand why they don't vote in their self-interest, which they identify with the corporate liberals of the Democratic Party primarily. So it's an interesting question. This was provoked by something that appeared online in the New York Times yesterday about whether it's ethical for people to vote in their own self-interest, or should they vote only in the public interest or social interest, and if they have some theory about what that is. So this is an article in New York Times called under the heading "The Stone" by Gary Gutting, who's a professor of philosophy at Notre Dame, and makes some interesting points, but just left me wanting more, something more precise. And I would only point out that this distinction between self-interest and social interest doesn't hold up very well for very long. And there are a lot of things that are both in our self-interest and in the social interest at the same time. We can picture those as a Venn diagram with overlapping circles or something. And there's a big area, the lens-shaped area in between. And can we make self-interest and social interest compatible? Well, a lot of work has been done on this in the past half century or so. All the talk about the commons and the problem of the commons, and then the prisoner's dilemma research showing that self-interest is, in most cases, if it's stupid and narrow at least, is self-defeating. And the slogan then becomes, everyone does better when everyone does better, which I think is quite true. But there it is. How can we get people to recognize that the social interest, the general interest, is very largely in their self-interest? And can they be reared or educated into seeing that the insight that in their longer term best interests, personally, is to help everyone to do better? So I think it's the job of parents, social morale, and the rest to lead people to this kind of insight that they can't be all that prosperous in the long run without the whole society being lifted up. This is the famous tide that lifts all boats. The trouble is, the way it's working out is it's only the yachts that are being lifted in the USA today, and the rowboats and kayaks and dinghies are getting completely drowned out. So I'll leave you with that thought for now.
Thank you very much, Ron. You're watching News from Neptune. We'll go to David Green for comments. We're going to come back and talk about some of these things. I've got a page full of notes from what Ron said already.
Yeah, I think it ties in with some things that are going on now. In fact, your first comment, Ron, referred to the matter of why it is that people who allegedly call themselves conservatives don't allegedly vote for their own interests, although those interests are being defined by people other than them.
Right.
And the books that are being written about them are by people other than them. One of those people was a fellow named Thomas Frank, who wrote a book called What's the Matter with Kansas? And that asks the question, refers to what's wrong with these people in Kansas, these working class people, these dispossessed people who vote conservative, quote unquote conservative, rather than liberal. Well, Thomas Frank has a new book out, believe it or not, called Listen, Liberal, or Whatever Happened to the Party of the People. So Thomas Frank, who's a good writer and a pretty good thinker, I didn't read his previous book. I may read this one. It's excerpted. You can find an excerpt on various websites. He's writing about liberals, and I think that really pertains to the kind of debates we're having now about Bernie Sanders and what's the Bernie Sanders phenomenon is and how far is it going to go and what's it going to mean. And Thomas Frank, instead of focusing his sights on Kansas in talking about liberals, has focused his sight on the great state of Massachusetts. He writes in this excerpt from the book, "The city's Route 128 corridor was the original model for the suburban tech district lined ever since it was built with defense contractors and computer manufacturers. The suburbs situated along this golden thoroughfare are among the wealthiest municipalities in the nation, populated by engineers, lawyers, and aerospace workers. Their public schools are excellent, their downtowns are cute, and back in the 70s, their socially enlightened residents were the prototype of the figure of the quote-unquote suburban liberal. Frank goes on, to think about it slightly more critically, Boston is the headquarters for two industries that are steadily bankrupting middle America, big learning and big medicine, both of them imposing costs that everyone else is basically required to pay and which increase at a far more rapid rate than wages or inflation. $1,000 a pill, 30 grand a semester, the debts that are gradually choking the life out of people where you live are what has made this city, that is Boston, so very rich. And then he continues on just to provide another brief excerpt. You can see what I mean when you visit Fall River, an old mill town 50 miles south of Boston. Median household income in that city is $33,000, among the lowest in the state. Unemployment is among the highest, 15%, in March 2014, nearly 5 years after the recession ended. 23% of Fall River's inhabitants live in poverty. The city lost its many fabric-making concerns decades ago, and with them lost its reason for being. People have been deserting the place for decades. So we need to think about what it is about liberals. If you ask the question why it is that conservatives, that people who are working class, allegedly don't vote in their own quote unquote self-interest, that is, they vote Republican. You can ask why it is that working class people who in a state like Massachusetts, which is a classic blue state, should vote liberal in light of the fact that the professional class with which Thomas Frank has focused his sights on, what a sociologist named Richard Florida or an urbanist named Richard Florida has called the creative class, why it is that these people in Fall River should be voting for, let's say, the Democratic Party, and the question may be, well, they've got Bernie Sanders to vote for now, and the question is, why should they vote for Hillary Clinton if it comes down to that in the fall? And I think this opens up some interesting questions that, as we're thinking about what it means, what the success of Bernie Sanders means. The Massachusetts primary was 2 or 3 weeks back, or a month back, and Sanders and Hillary Clinton split the vote evenly. There was, I think, a pretty good turnout. It was about 600,000 out of the perhaps 5 million eligible voters in that state. About 1.2 million voted in the Democratic presidential primary, and Hillary Clinton got a little more than 600,000, and Bernie Sanders got a little less, and they were separated by not much more than one percentage point. And the question I think that raises is that people are assuming that people who aren't voting for Bernie Sanders just don't get it. They just don't get that the Hillary, you know, these blue state people, whether it be a blue state like California or Massachusetts or our own state, where Hillary Clinton also barely won. What's with these blue state voters? What's with these Democratic Party voters? Well, I think Thomas Frank has provided us at least with an analysis that there is a professional class, a liberal class. Also the liberal class that is discussed by Chris Hedges in his book, The Death of the Liberal Class. There's a rather venal liberal class in this country that is not concerned about about poverty, that is not concerned about inequality of wealth, that still feels they're on the right side of all the competitiveness that's going on. And the Sanders phenomenon has partly proven them right and partly proven them wrong. There's been more discourse devoted to why blacks aren't voting for Bernie Sanders, but the question could also be asked, why aren't allegedly more generally liberal blue state people voting for Bernie Sanders? Well, they have one could argue that they have a perfectly good candidate to vote for. Hillary Clinton represents the kind of values that they have grown up with, that they have benefited from, and the kind of self-interest or definition of self-interest that Hillary Clinton embodies. So why not? It makes it seem like a really tough road to hoe for Bernie Sanders to convince this class of people that they should be voting for him rather than her. And I think it's a wake-up call to Bernie Sanders, to Bernie Sanders supporters. And I'll conclude with this. If Bernie Sanders becomes president, you know, I will support Bernie Sanders in his bid to become president if he needs me. But once Bernie Sanders becomes president, he is the enemy of people like me. He becomes the enemy of people like me. And what I mean by that, well, maybe you don't want to know, but it means that he is at that point possessed by the people that may marginally have decided or have marginally decided that he's a better candidate than Hillary Clinton. As Paul Street pointed out yesterday in an article on Counterpunch, it's quite possible that elites in this country will end up getting along with Bernie Sanders perfectly well. It's quite possible that elites in this country are more afraid of Donald Trump than they are of Bernie Sanders, that the military industrial complex is more afraid of Donald Trump than of Bernie Sanders. So lots on the table there.
I think that's true, and I think there's some parallels between them that are worthwhile following. I'm overwhelmed here with things that have emerged already from my colleagues' comments. There's a great deal to talk about, and I think it centers on some of the same issues and some of the same, indeed, misperceptions of the nature of American politics these days. You're watching News from Neptune. Carl Estabrook, Ron Zook, and David Green talking about the news of the week and its coverage by the media. And I think we have a live one here, gentlemen. I'd like to suggest that observation David just offered about the fear of the political class of Donald Trump and of Bernie Sanders may in fact work to Trump's benefit, if you want to put it that way, in that they're more afraid of Trump than they are of Sanders. They do recognize, I think, though, something that the rest of us have been maybe a little slow to recognize, that the impulse behind Trump and Sanders' campaign is the impulses are similar and represent a general dismay with the political class that has put the last generation and more of presidents in place, that there is a revolution bubbling along under the surface because of the very real circumstances of people's lives and how they've changed almost 40 years of neoliberalism. It's specific, though, to the actual policies of the United States government, and that's no bad thing. Glenn Ford, writing on the excellent Black Agenda Report collection of articles, has a piece from a week or two ago the headline on which is Trump Way to the Left of Clinton on Foreign Policy. In fact, he's damn near anti-empire. Ford goes on from that to analyze some of the questions that Ron was starting with. Why is it that Americans seem to vote against their own interests in many cases, Thomas Frank's original concern. Ford observed if the Bernie Sanders campaign has propelled the word socialism, if not its actual meaning, we've debated here about how appropriate it is to use that word for the Sanders campaign, but the word is being used and, to our amazement, is back in currency as a result. If that campaign has propelled the word socialism into common, benign American usage, Donald Trump may have done the world an even greater service by calling into question the very pillars of U.S. imperial policy, foreign war policy. The NATO alliance, the U.S. nuclear umbrella, the global network of thousands of a thousand U.S. bases, military containment of China and Russia, and U.S. strategic claims in the Persian Gulf. Were the U.S. to actually rid itself of these strategic obligations, in inverted commas, the military hand on the doomsday clock would immediately be rolled back. I think Ford's right about that. He says if the Trump candidacy can continue to thrive while rejecting the holiest shibboleths of the bipartisan war party, then we must conclude the whole U.S. foreign policy debate is a construct of the corporate media and the corporate bought duopoly political establishment, and that there is no popular consensus for U.S. militarism and no true mass constituency for war in either party. I think that's true, and I think that's right, that the Trump campaign, will they, nil they, is bringing that out. It's making that clear. They have worried our masters, the people who have run American foreign policy, the masters of the universe, as Pepe Escobar calls them, since the Second World War. Stephen Cohen is a retired Russia specialist who happens to be married to the editor of The Nation magazine, which quite remarkably came out for Bernie Sanders a week or two ago. Cohen, who writes well about Russia, says, whatever else one may think about Donald Trump as a presidential candidate, his foreign policy views expressed, however elliptically, in a Washington Post interview, an interview with the editors of the Washington Post a couple of weeks ago, should be welcomed for their challenge to the bipartisan neocon neoliberal principles and practices that have guided Washington policy making since the 1990s with disastrous results. That seems to me what Ford was saying as well. That policymaking has included the premise that the United States is the sole indispensable superpower with a right to intervene whenever it so decides, by military means and regime changes, and by using NATO as its own United Nations and rulemaker. That was an innovation of the first Clinton administration, by the way. In recent years, from Iraq and Libya to Ukraine and Syria, the results have been international instability. I mean, instability is American speak for war. War is both proxy and civil, growing terrorism, failed nation building, mounting refugee crisis, and a new Cold War with Russia. And that last may be the most serious. Trump proposes instead diplomacy. He calls it making deals, towards forming partnerships, including with Russia, rethinking the rightful mission of NATO, Europe taking political and financial responsibility for its own crises, as in Ukraine, and a smaller America, and what in fact happened in Ukraine was a crisis provoked and constructed by the United States, and a smaller American military footprint in the world, in effect a less missionary and militarized American national security policy. Cohen suggests that Trump may be calling on an older Republican foreign policy tradition, the one that was seriously excoriated by American liberals as isolationism in the 20th century, and that he's emerging as a realist in two respects, Trump is. In reality, the world is no longer unipolar, pivoting around Washington, as Washington has thought it was since the Second World War, and the United States must share and balance power with other great powers from Europe to Russia and China. The orthodox bipartisan establishment, Republican and Democrat alike, have reacted to Trump's proposals as though he is the foreign policy antichrist. That's Cohen's coinage, readying all-out assaults on his remarks. It's possible that this existential confrontation might lead, if the mainstream media does its job, to a public debate over U.S. foreign policy that has been missing for 20 years. I think he's optimistic there. It's been missing for longer than that. Certainly during the 2016 campaign, presidential campaign. And as an example of that very real threat that Trump poses to the neocon neoliberal consensus of both Republican and Democratic parties and all recent presidencies, we can see that weather vane of orthodox Republican, orthodox opinion, Charles Krauthammer, in this morning's News Gazette, telling us just how dangerous this sort of talk from Trump is, and how it's just not Republican at all. It's not possible that it could be the sort of thing that has guided American presidencies into war and destruction around the world for Krauthammer's entire lifetime, and therefore this man Trump has to be stopped. He's very dangerous. I think he's onto something. You're watching News from Neptune. We have put a great deal on the table in the first half hour here. I think what we'll do now is go around the table and ask for comments of the various viands that have been spread out before us so far. We'll start with Ron.
Let me just make one clarification before Ron talks. When I say that that if Bernie Sanders becomes president, then he's my enemy, or the enemy of many people who would vote for him. I only mean that that's no time to stop putting an enormous amount of pressure on Bernie Sanders and on the political process for him to do the things and to help him do the things that he says he wants, not because he's going to transform into something else, into Hillary Clinton or whatever. I'm not being nasty or mean when I'm saying that. I'm just talking. I mean, I could be nasty and mean, and that's fine. But in this case, I'm just basically saying that's no time for people who are voting for him for the right reasons to feel like, well, he's just going to get things done.
Yeah.
That's all.
Yeah. Okay. Do you guys think that Donald Trump has a foreign policy? Anything that's mildly coherent?
Say again?
Do you think that Donald Trump has a foreign policy? Anything that's mildly coherent or is even capable of coming up with one? His record is not good.
He says so. I mean, in fact...
Right. He says lots of things.
Yeah. So does Obama, and even more Mrs. Clinton. Cohen is working here, and Ford too, I think, the things I was quoting on, were referring particularly to a long interview that Trump gave to the editors of the Washington Post, as presidential candidates often have. While Mrs. Clinton tells us that she doesn't like Sanders' tone and really doesn't want to debate these issues, Trump is talking to one of the most conservative newspapers in the country, in many ways a wholly owned subsidiary of the CIA, the Washington Post, and publishing the talk. The talk was not off the record. The conversation is there to be read, and it's that Cohen was summarizing and commenting on. And commenting on the importance of the talk precisely because it attacks the consensus, the neocon consensus on foreign policy in both the Republican and Democratic parties. So do I think Trump has anything to say here? Yes, I do.
Yeah. Well, his views seem to be constantly evolving from one day to the next. And so I think this is a very slender read.
But if he produces the debate, that's the good thing, hey?
Oh,
I mean,
okay.
If we actually have a debate for the first time about American foreign policy, that would be a very good thing. Even if the debate takes before, which
see,
Donald Trump
I
do
see.
You like?
Okay.
You know?
That's the standard retreat. Well, at least he's stirring up controversy and debate.
He's not stirring up controversy and debate. He's saying things about American foreign policy that have not been said.
Maybe there's a reason for
that. Of course there's a reason for it, because it doesn't represent the wishes of the 1%. Republicans and Democrats have, running for president for more than a generation, have not differed substantially in the use of American power. What they have differed in is how they characterize it. Trump really does differ, and he really is scaring the intellectual bodyguards of the American 1%, like Charles Krauthammer. Good for him.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that Trump has any coherent critique, overall critique of foreign policy, especially from a leftist or class-based point of view. But it's clear that he does understand and does mean and understands where his support comes from in regard, for instance, to quote-unquote free trade. He realizes he's appealing to voters who've lost jobs or live in communities that have been adversely affected by quote-unquote free trade, NAFTA, and so forth. And he understands that. So what he can do institutionally in response to that is hard to say. What he can do institutionally in response to the foreign policies that have been institutionalized in this country for 200 years, or especially since World War II, that's hard to say because these are powerful institutional forces. But he does, I think, understand, A, that the kind of people that are voting for him are adversely affected by free trade. They're adversely affected by bearing the burdens of war. I mean, sure, it may sound a little silly for him to say, well, NATO will have to play its part, or European countries will have to play their part. If we're gonna invade the Middle East, they'll have to help too. But he isn't invested in, I mean, he has a sort of a peculiar notion of American exceptionalism that allows for a little bit of traditional isolationism, and he's hard to categorize in that sense. And I don't think, again, it's hard to know what he's coherent about, and it's hard to know what he really means, and it's hard to know what he would really accomplish in relation to institutional forces. But I think what he's appealing to is very real. And I think he understands what he's appealing to is very real in terms of the dissatisfaction that the kind of people that Thomas Frank, that you referred to at the start of the show, don't vote their self-interest. Well, Donald Trump is appealing to their self-interest in a way that, Sam Brownback, the governor of Kansas, isn't.
Do you think they understand their self-interest, or are we back into the classical debates about false consciousness here?
Well,
I think it's more than the classical debates on false consciousness, Ron. I mean, we are living in a political world that has had a remarkable transformation into tremendously powerful attempts to control the public consciousness, to misrepresent what our rulers are doing to the public consciousness, precisely because the danger that the public may begin to understand how its interests are not being protected by our rulers, but are rather being invaded, that you could control that by the knout in the prison cell and so forth, and you still can in many parts of the world, or at least some people seem to think so, in places like Israel and Saudi Arabia. But the capitalist democracies, or the capitalist states, decided at the beginning of the 20th century that the method wasn't working. Largely because of the growth of the socialist movement from the 19th century. They found that they really couldn't repress the demands of the populace for things that were in the populace interest, and therefore they had to find some other way to control it. Well, examples of that we've talked about here before, such as the Creel Commission and in the First World War, when the Democrats had to convince Americans who were strongly opposed to being involved in a European war that it was in their interest to do so, and worked very hard to do it. They discovered propaganda, and propaganda, convincing people of things that are in fact not in their interests, has been the name of the game for particularly American politics for a century now. It was noticed early on. I've mentioned before that Hitler and Mein Kampf written in the 20s, said, why did we lose the First World War? He's talking about Germany. He said, because the propaganda systems of the British and the American were better than ours. We won't make that mistake again, says Hitler. So it was clear what was going on from early on in the 20th century. And we've constructed a politics in which people are programmatically misled about what their interests are. And the attempt of people to reassert their interests, as David was saying, in the Trump and Sanders campaign is greeted with horror and outrage by our political rulers. And an interesting twist on that is that they try to make the people who are violating this propaganda system themselves the issue. If Hillary Clinton can make the general election into a crusade against bigotry and intolerance, as embodied by Donald Trump, she can win with an otherwise issueless campaign, thus shielding the 1% from harm. That seems to me right.
Isn't that standard to, divert attention to issues of patriotism and values? Dividing the electorate along lines of these social and value issues, such as abortion, lifestyle, and so on. And,
yeah, that's how the ruling elite has done it in the last since the 1960s.
Yeah, divide and conquer.
Since the 1970s. Well, it's identity politics. It's the reliance on the fact that you identify with being. Regarding abortion or guns or racism or valid issues regarding rights, but rights framed in the notion of identity politics rather than rights framed on a class basis, on a collective solidarity oriented class basis. That's the thing that the dominant debate, the dominant discourse wants to avoid, is having people vote not just their interests or self-interest, but their class interests, meaning working class interests, meaning that over this period of time, it's become clear that anybody who relies on a wage for a living has suffered. As the median family income has stagnated, and all the usual litany of things that have happened in the last 35 to 40 years, people realize that it's only Wall Street that's benefited, only the 1% that's benefited from the way the system has worked.
And the essential cover for this is to have a smooth-talking salesman convince you that what you see happening is not happening. The success of Barack Obama is written in the stars.
You're going to believe me or your lying eyes?
There you are. You're watching News from Neptune. We have many other things to talk about. I think that I'm reminded of Thomas Pynchon, one of the prophets of the modern age, and his Proverbs for Paranoids, one of which is, if they can get you asking the wrong question, they don't have to worry about answers.
How do we find out what are the right questions?
This is our job. This is analysis. This is the sorts of things that we should be doing here. And I do want to suggest that it's become increasingly difficult, perhaps more difficult in our generation, for Americans of our generation, I'll leave open the question of what our generation is, than it is for Americans of earlier generations. The old man in the British Museum, in writing about capitalism, and remember, that was what Karl Marx was writing about. He was not giving a blueprint for the future.
He was writing about capital, not capitalism.
He was writing about capitalism, which is a word he essentially coined. And capitalism being the way in which capital actually operates covertly and secretly in the society. That's what the book, the collection of articles called Capital, was about. But his point was that the class relationships among in a society dominated by the bourgeoisie, dominated by the capital class, the class relationships there were necessarily obfuscated. They were necessarily unclear. His job was to make it clear. They were necessarily unclear because if they became clear to the people who were being exploited by the system, they wouldn't want to be exploited anymore. So that misrepresentation, that construct of the public mind was essential to the rule of capital. I want to suggest, from what we were saying a moment ago, that from the time of the First World War, from the, or the Easter Rebellion, if you like, to the present, that's become even more important and increasingly so. Marx himself said that a class that was being exploited, like the working class under capitalism, had to go from being a class an sich to being a class für sich. That is, from being a class in itself, the objective reality, so to speak, of the class position, to a class that recognizes that, that becomes a class for itself, understanding what its situation really is. Now, the identity politics that David just mentioned is a brilliant modern attempt, brilliant because it's based on attacking very real evils in the society. It's a brilliant modern attempt to prevent a class, which is a class an sich, becoming a class for itself, for a class to really recognize its situation. That was threatening to happen in America in the 1970s. And suddenly the notion was that instead of a reformist tradition that began with the New Deal, that led to people recognizing their real political position, their real economic position in the society, a condition that doesn't depend upon thinking one way or another, they should turn their attention to things that did depend upon people thinking one way or another, like racism or sexism. That sort of concern should take the realm of politics and not the real objective situation in which people were being exploited. That's what we're against. That's what we need to break down. Yeah. That's what we need to get people to understand.
That's where the idea of false consciousness then again enters the picture.
Well,
promoted
actually,
by advertising and government propaganda.
I think the term was coined by socialists of the late 19th century who were dealing with precisely the problem we're talking about.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of times the notion of false consciousness, I think, is put the criticism of that idea, is put forward as a criticism of the sort of the vanguard of the working class, that there's people who understand better what your interests are than you do, that somehow they get it and you don't, and I suppose that accusation can be true enough, and it's certainly operating within the context of the Sanders campaign. Now it's operating in relation to the issue of race. Some black people are being told, why aren't you voting for your interests? Why don't you see that Bernie Sanders is going to be better for black people than Hillary Clinton is? And then other people, even people on the left, are saying, well, it's pretty clear that Bernie Sanders has not appealed very well to black people, and that black people are mainly concerned with keeping Republicans out of power rather than voting between Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton. So people on the left have to be a little bit careful about sounding patronizing, condescending, and so forth, and being accused and putting forward this as if people. People understand the objective circumstances of their lives. It's not patronizing for people to say that people may not understand what the underlying forces are. It's up to people to explain to them how it is that it got to be that you have wealth managers south of Windsor Drive and you have payday loans north of Bradley. Those are the kind of things that we have to be talking about.
But it's not wrong to say people don't understand their circumstances when we have one of the most massive propaganda campaigns in history that for literally generations have been trying to get people to misunderstand their circumstances. It works. People, these campaigns work. What's remarkable is when they don't work. What's remarkable is how incomplete they finally are, and that people can break through and sort of see their situation with help and effort.
Well, a lot depends on being able to pump people up with enthusiasm for symbolic goals and gratifications and so on, such as making America great again, whatever that means. And another one that's probably too hot to handle is the success in splitting many social movements along gender lines, and this thing that feminism has turned into, in some cases, corporate feminism. You should support Hillary because she'll be the first woman to become president and break the glass ceiling and so on. And there are a lot of women, especially working class women, who are not falling for this at all, but maybe that one's too hot to handle.
Vote for Hitler because Austrians have been discriminated against.
Yeah, I think there's a lot, there's a debate going on in response to Thomas Frank's book, and if you look at blogs like Corey Robbins' blog, there's a sort of revival of grappling with the sort of generational aspect of what's going on right now, which is always a little dangerous because generational analysis doesn't usually is a way of distracting us from class analysis. Yet there is a generational phenomenon going on right now in response to the Bernie Sanders campaign, and people are talking about in relation to Gen X, the baby, of course, the baby boomers, Gen X, and the so-called millennials, and as to what their various experiences have been, and with the caveat that, of course, any generation's experience run along class lines, and we see now very clear demarcations between kids growing up in households in which they can go to college without going into debt, and those who have to go into debt, and that many of those who don't have to go into debt are relatively the ones more assured of getting jobs anyway than the ones getting decent jobs anyway than the ones that do have to go into debt. So there are real, of course, class lines there. But there's a sense, I think, that's being debated that people, the four out of, I think it was something like 5,000 students at the U of I polling places around the U of I who voted a couple of weeks ago, of the 5,000, 4,000 voted for Bernie Sanders. And that there is more openness now among younger people towards the notion of socialism, towards seeing that as a positive thing and not a negative thing. And without analyzing that in strictly generational terms, I think the idea is to understand that these young people have identified their class position within the way America works. They're beginning to understand, again, not through maybe having a deep understanding of how Wall Street has worked and how pension funds have worked and so forth. They're beginning to, their understanding through their material experience, their lived experience, that they have no future. I think this is something Corey Robin pointed out in one of his very recent blog posts, is that we've created a generation that sees itself as having no future. And it's taken 40 years of work to do that. People of my age may have had the experience of living through this and beginning to understand how all that happened. But they immediately, the younger people, immediately understand that what all this has ended up with is they're having no viable future of not being in debt, of they have no future of getting out of debt, they have no future of being able to buy homes and all the things that supposedly constitute the quote unquote American dream.
I've been recommending Glenn Ford's writings on the current political situation, and he's one of the few I know who's raised the question of why it is that blacks in America seem to be voting for Hillary Clinton instead of Bernie Sanders, when it looks as though Sanders would be more would be closer to their interests. It's an important question. What Ford points out is that taken as a group, blacks in America are, first of all, the most socially progressive group similar size, and the most pacifist, the most anti-war group of any groups of similar size. Now, how could it be that a socially progressive and pacifist and anti-war community lines up for a pro-war, pro-Wall Street candidate like Hillary Clinton? And Ford's account is that you have to look at the way in which the Democrats have been able to make themselves the standard bearers against the white man's party. The white man's party being, of course, the Republicans. And that the Democrats, who in our lifetimes have included some quite remarkable races, the Democrats are understood by American blacks as being the party, the only party that has their interests at all at heart in opposition to the white man's party, to the Republicans. And therefore, they vote for the apparently most electable Democrat. Now, that has to be broken up, says Ford. People have to be told the truth on these matters. And he's one of the few people, it seems to me, is doing it.
I'm afraid Mr. Ford is a little deluded on this. Many people don't realize, especially among our liberal leftist colleagues, just how deeply conservative older black people are.
That's not what the polls show, and Ford is quoting the polls at some length. Yeah. In order to make that point.
Well, okay. Some aspects of religious conservatism right. don't necessarily correlate with political conservatism.
Yeah.
I mean, I think, and I haven't read it, I'm not familiar with that data, but I think what Ford is saying is that they're politically liberal in terms of the role of government and in terms of being anti-war. And of course, the Clintons have been able to play that very, yep. very well, yeah. and Hillary Clinton is still playing it well. But as I brought up before, I think the other question has to do with what kind of liberals, white liberals or otherwise, does Hillary Clinton appeal to in their interests, their class interests? She's playing a kind of dangerous game because she's trying to, on the one hand, she perfectly well understands she's appealing to affluent white people who want to think of themselves as being socially liberal, but she's having to appeal on, Sanders is forcing her to appeal on more of a class basis and more of a purely economic basis to some groups of people. And I think this has been, facile words perhaps, but this has been a really, really interesting and fascinating process and really shows that we are in a time of potential meaningful change, but that will only happen if the people are very skeptical of what our leaders and our institutional leaders tell us.
The position of American blacks in the election seems to me to be the best possible illustration of the sea change that came in when identity politics was chosen to be the liberal substitution for class politics in the 1970s. And I will post Ford's articles on this point to the Facebook page for News from Neptune in order to make this point. You've been watching News from Neptune for the 13th week of 2016, a first day of April edition. I'm Carl Estabrook. My discussants tonight have been Ron Zook and David Green. Our thanks to our directors and producers, Jason and Yosef. Inshallah, we'll be back next week with a new edition of News from Neptune to remind you, in the words of Edward DeVere, what's past is prologue, what to come in yours and my discharge. In the meantime, confusion to our enemies, and a good night to you.